अस्सलाम वालेकुम। ओके गाइस, लेट्स स्टार्ट डिस्कसिंग आर टेस्ट वीक पेपर, बिकॉज आई कुड सी मेनी ऑफ यू हैव मेड मेनी सिली मिस्टेक्स। सो लेट्स क्लैरिफाई आर कॉन्सेप्ट्स सो दैट वी नो व्हाई यू नो द आंसर्स दैट यू मार्क्ड वर रॉन्ग। सो वी स्टार्ट विद द एमसीक्यू पोर्शन फर्स्ट। विच टाइप्स ऑफ बॉन्ड्स मेंटेन द टर्शियरी स्ट्रक्चर ऑफ अ प्रोटीन मॉलिक्यूल? सो इट इज was so clearly discussed in the class that there are four kinds of bonds which maintain the tertiary structure of a molecule, namely disulfide, hydrogen, ionic and hydrophobic interactions. So of course hydrophobic interactions have not been given over here, so the most correct option is option A, this one, which includes disulfide, hydrogen, ionic, and of course peptide bond is never a feature that maintains a tertiary structure. Peptide bonds are actually responsible for the maintenance of the primary structure. Let's move on. What is the general formula for starch? So the general formula for starch, the correct option was this one. Achha, many students might have got this wrong because you did not remember that when a starch molecule is formed, it needs lots of alpha glucose molecules to condense with each other and to form a starch molecule. So as we keep lining up many alpha glucose molecules and condensing them, we cannot do it without the removal of a water molecule. And if we remove a water molecule end to end, we will see that the general formula of starch will not be C6H12O6, rather it will be C6H10NO5, because of the removal of the water molecule which is needed to achieve condensation of many alpha glucose molecules lying in a line. Moving on to the third question, the hexose sugar molecule in the diagram has its six carbon atoms numbered. Very clearly it shows you. This is a very simple question. Which carbon atoms join by glycosidic bonds to form amylose and amylopectin? So you had to select those bonds which are responsible for amylose and those which are also responsible for amylopectin. So this is the best option. For amylose, we all know it's 1 to 4, and for amylopectin, it can be 1 to 4 and 1 to 6, both. So option A is the correct one. Which statement about triglycerides is correct? Triglycerides are made up of three fatty acids combined with glycogen, of course wrong. They are more saturated with hydrogen compared with phospholipids, wrong. They form a bilayer in the membranes of the cells, wrong, because the bilayer is not formed by triglycerides, it's formed by phospholipids. They have a lower ratio of oxygen to carbon compared with carbohydrates, yes, of course, because this is the ratio of oxygen to carbon in carbohydrates. Oxygen to carbon. Look at this ratio. And let's suppose if I give you the formula of any random fat molecule, you are not supposed to remember the formulae, but let's suppose if this is the formula, you can see that the ratio of oxygen to carbon is much lower in case of triglycerides as compared to carbohydrates. Look at the ratio of oxygen to carbon in triglycerides. Okay, moving on. When a peptide bond is formed, which statement is correct? One amino acid loses a hydroxyl group from its amine group? No, not at all. One amino acid loses a hydroxyl group from its carboxyl group? Yes, because we have a carboxyl group which is COOH and we have an amine group which is NH2. So the OH group is removed from the carboxyl group to make a peptide bond. Both amino acids lose a hydrogen atom from their amine group? Wrong. Both amino acids lose a hydrogen atom from their carboxyl group? Wrong. This was also super easy. So this is the correct answer, 5B. Which sequence correctly identifies a change in colors during a Benedict's test? So first blue and then green and yellow and then brown and red. That's the sequence. So answer is B. Lactose is a disaccharide present in the milk of mammals. How will a baby mammal benefit from having this sugar instead of a monosaccharide in the milk? Thinking about, you know, what could be the most possible answer. Let's keep eliminating all the wrong answers. Condensation of disaccharides enables rapid production of glycogen. Doesn't make sense at all. Disaccharides can be transported across the membranes for more rapid absorption. No. Disaccharides will be broken down. How will they be transported? They have to be broken down in the baby's digestive system. Disaccharides have a higher energy value than triglycerides. Doesn't make any sense. Hydrolysis of the glycosidic bond in the disaccharide lactose gives a gradual release of monosaccharides. We know that lactose is a combination of glucose and galactose. So if the baby is given lactose, the breakdown of the glycosidic bond in lactose will give a gradual release of monosaccharide, right? Okay. When investigating question number 8, the rate of reaction of the enzyme lipase on the hydrolysis of triglycerides, the pH must be maintained at an optimum to prevent the lipase denaturing. So we know that when the lipase is going to break down triglycerides, it will break it down into glycerol and fatty acids. And the fatty acids will decrease the pH of the medium or whatever. So the products of hydrolysis are the fatty acids, so they are going to decrease the pH. Hence the correct option is B. Then we move on to number 9. Which molecules have a structural formula that contains COO bonds, which means carbon that makes a double bond with oxygen? So the options are, yes of course the fatty acids, question number 9, which molecules have a structural formula that contains C with a double bond with oxygen? So for this, the option is, correct option is fatty acids and glucose. They have these bonds, whereas glycerol doesn't have. You can see the structure of glycerol in your textbook. So the correct option is A. And then number 10, which level of protein structure maintains the globular shape of enzymes? So tertiary structure maintains the globular shape of enzyme. In fact, you were taught that globular and tertiary can be used as synonyms of each other, right? It is the tertiary structure that gives an enzyme its globular or spherical shape. Okay, moving on. I think most of you got these questions correct. They were very easy. Statements A to E relate to biological molecules. For each statement, identify the most appropriate term that matches the description. The molecule formed from a condensation reaction between fructose and glucose is sucrose. Then we have the name of the bond that is broken when two amino acids are separated by hydrolysis. So that's the peptide bond. The unbranched polymer consisting only of beta glucose molecules, such an obvious prompt which is given to you, so cellulose. The reagent used to test for the presence of protein, biuret. The molecule produced in addition to fatty acids when a triglyceride is hydrolyzed, glycerol. Okay, the type of bond that joins these two monosaccharides in lactose, so glycosidic bond. Many of you, you know, it was so disappointing to see that many of you have written disulfide bond and I don't know what kind of bonds. It's so simple, it's a disaccharide. And you can see these two monosaccharides. So what could connect two monosaccharides together is a glycosidic bond. Mentioning whether it was 1,4 or 1,2 was irrelevant in this case. The examiner did not need any of these descriptions. The enzyme lactase catalyzes the breakage of bond between the two monosaccharides in lactose. Name the type of reaction that breaks this bond, hydrolysis. Some of you have even done this wrong, which was also very disappointing. I think this part of the question, which is of 7 marks, was the easier part of the test. A test always has to be balanced, in which we include some challenging questions and some easy questions. So 100% of you should have got full marks in this part. Moving on to this part. And this was also very easy. The last page was only difficult. Okay, so after looking at all these diagrams, you were supposed to say or to tell, state the name of the covalent bond. Look at this prompt, covalent bond that forms when cysteine is added to the growing chain of amino acids. Okay, so the answer to this question is the peptide bond. Because many of you got confused and wrote down disulfide bond because you did not see the diagram carefully. Cysteine being added to the growing chain of amino acids means you are actually elongating the chain of amino acids, and elongation means that you are adding another amino acid, and you cannot do this without the usage of the peptide bond. So there is no question of mentioning the disulfide bond over here. This was sort of straightforward but a little bit tricky. Okay, now this diagram was shown to you very obviously, you know, even if you don't remember anything and you just look at the picture, it shows you two very obvious levels of organization of protein, and those are in fact one level in which there are two varieties, and that level is known as the secondary structure. Now I can see the secondary structure in this diagram, and I can see two varieties of secondary structure, the alpha helix and the beta pleated sheet. Where are those? This is the alpha helix, okay, and this is the beta pleated sheet, right? In fact, the beta pleated sheet starts like this. If I just follow this, it goes like this and like this, right? Okay. So figure 3.2 is a ribbon diagram showing the three-dimensional structure of a protein from the bacterium Streptococcus. Describe the secondary structure of the protein shown in figure 3.2. Shown in figure 3.2. Very, very simple question. Even if a student just writes down that I can see the alpha helical structure and the beta pleated sheet, that would have got you 2 marks. And of course you have to describe, so you can simply write down that the alpha helix can be seen and the beta pleated sheet can be seen. Achha. Explain why the protein shown in figure 3.2 has a tertiary structure but not a quaternary structure. Let's look at this diagram and let's try to find out two reasons, because explain says the examiner wants you to give two reasons why the protein which is shown in figure 3.2 has a tertiary structure and not a quaternary structure. Now to answer this question, every student must know what is the main difference between a tertiary and a quaternary level of organization. To label a protein as having a quaternary structure, it should be made up of more than one polypeptide chain, more than one polypeptide chain, like 2, 3, 4 and so on. And if I say tertiary structure, it means it should look like an extremely folded and a coiled protein, right? Now the examiner is asking you to give two reasons why the protein shown in figure 3.2 has a tertiary structure but not a quaternary structure, which means that the examiner is 100% sure that this diagram is showing you a protein with tertiary structure. It is extensively folded, it is coiled. It is showing you a secondary structure also, but it's not showing you a primary, a quaternary structure. So you will say that in a quaternary protein, it should be made up of more than one polypeptide. Whereas this protein, which is shown over here, is made up of a single polypeptide. Right? And I think even if you just write down this answer, it would have been more than enough. Yes, the examiner says that alternate valid points, like this diagram does not show any prosthetic group. If somebody writes this, that is also accepted as correct. But this is it. There are some additional marking scheme points which say that the reason why this is not a protein showing a quaternary structure is that over here the interactions which are found, the bonds which are found, they are between the R groups of the on the same polypeptide and not between the R groups on different polypeptides. But I think this point only maybe one or two students in your class have written this point, even if you write down that this is not a quaternary protein because it is not made up of more than one polypeptide, it is made up of a single polypeptide, and it also does not show any prosthetic groups, which is a basic quality of the quaternary proteins. Also, it does not show interactions between the R groups of amino acids on different polypeptides. It shows the interactions between the R groups of amino acids on the same polypeptide. And what's the proof? The proof is the secondary structure, which is seen over here, because secondary structure is proof to the fact that there are R group interactions between amino acids on the same polypeptide, not on the different polypeptides. Okay, then we move on to the last question, which I was very disappointed to see that majority of you could not answer this question, although this was so obvious. The prompt that was given to you was very, very obvious. Okay, let me read out the question. An analysis of the amino acid composition of the protein, which is shown in figure 3.2, the same diagram, showed that it does not contain any cysteine residues, meaning that structure that is shown to you over here, this structure, when the analysis of this structure was done, it showed that it did not contain cysteine. If I say it doesn't contain cysteine, it means it does not contain any amino acid that has disulfide bonds or sulfhydryl groups, right? So this means very quickly you should eliminate the possibility of disulfide bridges within this molecule of protein that you can see on the diagram, right? But at the same time, you know that it is a tertiary protein, or it's a protein having a tertiary structure. So at once, the thought that should come in your mind should be that this is a protein having a tertiary structure in which the bonds that were involved were hydrogen, ionic, and hydrophobic. Disulfide eliminated. Why? Because the examiner is telling me that when the analysis of this protein was done, it showed that it had no cysteine residues. So if any student is mentioning the disulfide bond involvement in this answer, it will be totally discredited. No marks will be given for that. So 3 marks are given, okay, and you are supposed to give 3 reasons to explain what? To explain the 3-dimensional structure of the protein shown, how it is held in place. What does the examiner want you to write down? He wants you to write down 3 reasons to support how is the 3-dimensional structure of the protein shown in figure 3.2 held in place. Now, to hold it in place, of course, we need how many bonds? We need hydrogen bonds. We need ionic bonds. And we need the hydrophobic interactions. Now, you are an AS student, you are no longer in O level. If you just mention the name of these bonds, you cannot get 3 marks at all. You have to explain to the examiner how are these bonds holding this 3-dimensional structure in place. So you will say hydrogen bonds are formed between, you all know, between the oxygen of the CO, right, and the hydrogen of NH group of the amino acids, or you can say between the R groups, okay, you can say between 2 polar R groups. If some student writes down hydrogen bonds form between 2 polar R groups, that's also correct. If another student is actually describing the details of between which atom and which atom, that's also correct, right? Acha, ionic bonds you can write down between charged R groups. If a student writes down between 2 charged R groups, correct. If you want to write even a better answer, you can say ionic bonds between R groups with this and this group, right? अच्छा, एंड देन हाइड्रोफोबिक इंटरैक्शंस बिटवीन द नॉन पोलर आर ग्रुप्स. ऑफ कोर्स हाइड्रोफोबिक इंटरैक्शंस आर बिटवीन नॉन पोलर आर ग्रुप्स, राइट? सो इफ यू राइट डाउन दिस इट वुड हैव बीन इनफ. एंड देन ऑल्सो since they are, you know, since this question is not specifically about the tertiary structure, they are saying explain how the three dimensional structure of the protein shown in figure 3.2 is held in place. So there are some students, you know, who have explained the tertiary structure with respect to three bonds, and there are some students who have also given a separate explanation for the secondary structure with respect to the alpha helix and the beta pleated sheet. So if you are going to write like that, that's also acceptable, because in the diagram we can see the alpha helix and we can also see the beta pleated sheet. So if someone has written that in this diagram the alpha helix, each NH forms hydrogen bonds with the CO in the same polypeptide, that's also correct. If any other student writes down that I can also see that the beta pleated in the beta pleated sheet, each NH forms hydrogen bond with the CO on the parallel part of the polypeptide chain, right? That's also correct. But you know, the thing is that even if a student has completely missed out on this and he just focuses on these three points, emphasizing on how these bonds are playing a role in holding in place the three-dimensional structure of the protein shown in figure 3.2, you would have got the marks. Okay, so I end my discussion on the paper, and I hope this review of the paper benefits you all. Thank you.